Welcome to all who are either back for the last installment of our series with David Mosley or here for the first time. I'm so glad you're here and so glad that we have David Mosley with us. I'll invite you before we begin to mute until we have a time for questions at the end. And so that we can hear all that David has to offer us this morning without any background noise. We are in part four of our Advent series on this fourth Sunday of Advent, where David is a wonderful biblical scholar, theologian. You consider yourself more of a biblical scholar, David, or a systematic theologian, or all of the above, or?
I'm a systematic theologian by training. I just play a biblical scholar on Zoom.
Okay, so systematic theologian. He teaches religion at the Bishop School, Episcopal School in La Jolla, and is just sort of an all-around expert in the diocese that people go to for, well, systematic theology, and I'll throw in biblical scholarship because I think he's certainly teaching me things that I did not know. So so with that, let's say a prayer and then we'll get started on part four of our Advent series. The Lord be with you.
So with you.
Let us pray. Gracious and Holy One, we give you thanks for this day as we come together to worship you in preparation for the incarnation and our celebrations surrounding the joy of your coming into this world. We remember all those afflicted with COVID in the world as it groans in anticipation of your coming. We await the coming of vaccines, the coming of hope, the coming of relief and healing and physical relief from our waiting for so long. We pray for healthcare workers, for essential workers, for scientists and researchers, for those in isolation, for all those in this entire world, your human family. As we wait for you, the light that shall not be overcome by the darkness, gather us now as we learn more about you and we strive to open our hearts to the love that shall overcome all. In Christ's name we pray, amen. David.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our last class in our series on the Not So Holy Land, and we'll see some not so holy stuff in our class today. I just want to take this opportunity to thank Father Jeff and Dean Penny for inviting me to be with you just through this Advent series. It's been a pleasure, even if it is being with you virtually. I always have a great deal of affection for all the times that I've been with you at the cathedral, and it's been great to be back with you during this most difficult of times. As I was driving in this morning, I was listening to a story on NPR about the Persian festival of Yalda, which starts tonight. That's their midwinter festival. There's their version of the solstice. If we were in ancient Roman times, it would be the Saturnalia, which was a kind of debauched orgiastic festival that celebrated the rebirth of the year, a celebration of Saturn or Kronos, Father Time. And of course, this is the festival that Christians expropriated in the fourth century, and in order to guide Romans away from debauched orgiastic behavior, they declared rather randomly that if this was the birth of Jesus, the Mass of Christ or Christ's Mass, and therefore from that point onwards, the birth of Jesus was celebrated instead of or in place of the Saturnalia, although as we observed in the first class, the only indication we have of when Jesus was born in the Gospels itself is the indication in Luke's Gospel that there are shepherds out during the night keeping watch over their sheep, which would seem to indicate that it's lambing season, which would be in mid to late spring, March, April, or maybe even into May, and not midwinter, as we thought. And so that's another one of those myths or folkloric elements that we find in the biblical narrative. I also was listening to one of the Sunday shows as I was getting ready today, and there were various senators and congressmen being interviewed about the negotiations that are taking place for a stimulus bill. It's a couple of days before Christmas, and many of our fellow Americans are hungry, they're unemployed, they're facing risks of eviction. And this is a situation that we were in 10 years ago in the middle of the Great Recession, when again, Congress was delaying the opportunity to pass a stimulus bill to help out the most needy Americans. In fact, Congress was actually considering ending unemployment benefits just before Christmas 10 years ago. So let's check in for a timely reminder of a clip from our favorite biblical scholar and theologian, which culminates — I've played this clip a number of times before in classes, so this may be familiar to some of you — but this culminates in what I think is one of the most profoundest comments about Christianity in the United States in the 21st century.
Just seems to me that the Democrats don't get Christmas. Another example, Congressman Jim McDermott, who used the baby Jesus to push his pro-poor people agenda. Jim?
This is Christmas time. We talk about Good Samaritans. We talk about the poor, the little baby Jesus in the cradle, and all this stuff. And then we say to the unemployed, we won't give you a check to feed your family. That's simply wrong.
Of course it's wrong. We shouldn't be talking to them at all. They've got unemployment cooties. And I am not the only one upset by McDermott's flagrant injection of charity into the Christmas season. So is Papa Bear Bill O'Reilly. In his weekly column, he wrote, every fair-minded person should support government safety nets for people who need assistance through no fault of their own. But guys like McDermott don't make distinctions like that. For them, the baby Jesus wants us to provide, no matter what the circumstance. But being a Christian, I know that while Jesus promoted charity at the highest level, he was not self-destructive. Good point, Bill. Jesus said we only have to love those who deserve it. And what I like best about Bill's argument is its complete factual inaccuracy. Because it would be inconvenient to guys like us to repeat what Jesus actually said. For instance, if someone wants your coat, give them your cloak as well. Rich people should sell all their possessions and give the money to the poor. Plus, the fact is, Jesus was way beyond self-destructive. He was self-sacrificial. I mean, the guy is God. He could have floated off that cross like Chris Angel, Mind Freak. And I love how Bill closes with, the Lord helps those who help themselves, kind of implying that Jesus said that, when it was actually Ben Franklin, who I believe belched out that proverb between mouthfuls of French whore. But as much as I'm a fan of Bill's willfully ignorant, borderline heretical self-justification, I gotta tip my hat to Bernie Goldberg, who came on The Factor to call Jesus like he sees us. Jim?
As a matter of fact, you know, Jesus probably would be, except for one or two issues, a liberal Democrat if he were around today.
Yes. Jesus was a liberal Democrat. It's right there in his name. Jesus H. Christ. That H clearly stands for Hussein. Plus, Jesus was always flapping his gums about the poor, but not once did he call for tax cuts for the wealthiest 2% of Romans, even though they create all the good slave jobs. And don't forget, Jesus hung out with tax collectors and prostitutes, and no good conservative would be caught dead with tax collectors. What really frightens me about this is now we know we got a liberal Jesus seated at the right hand of the Father. He's basically Yahweh's Joe Biden. Anything happens to the big guy, we could end up with a socialist deity redistributing my loaves and fishes. Well, it hurts me to say this, folks, but if Jesus really is a liberal, it's time to get the Christ out of Christmas. Now, listen, you know me. I'm no fan of the term Xmas or X anything. I make my kids play Christbox 360. And if they break a bone, they get Christ rays. But it is time to take baby Jesus out of the manger. Replace him with something that's easier to swallow. How about a honey-baked ham? Because if this is going to be a Christian nation that doesn't help the poor, either we've got to pretend that Jesus was just as selfish as we are, or we've got to acknowledge that he commanded us to love the poor and serve the needy without condition, and then admit that we just don't want to do it. Merry Xmas, everybody.
All right, so I'll just let that quote sit with you for a moment, because I think this is the one of the most profound things that anyone has said.
Tide Pods Ultra Oxy one-ups the cleaning power of liquid.
Can it one-up spaghetti night?
It sure can.
Can it one-up breakfast in bed?
Yeah, for sure. Thanks, boys.
Sorry about that interruption. The video clip was playing on to the next commercial. Let me go back to the screen. Here we go. So here's that quote again. If this is going to be a Christian nation that doesn't help the poor, either we have to pretend that Jesus was just as selfish as we are, or we've got to acknowledge that he commanded us to love the poor and serve the needy without condition, and then admit that we just don't want to do it. Not much has changed in the last 10 years, sadly. All right, let's move on to our final day today. We are going to be looking at another Grinch from history, and that is Herod the Great, because we're going to be looking at Herod the Great's Israel, the Israel that Jesus was born into 2,000 years ago, and the person who ruled over Israel, who figures prominently, particularly in Matthew's account, because of the interactions that Herod the Great has in Jerusalem with the wise men from the east, and then his attempts to destroy this potential threat to his power, this new baby Messiah born in Bethlehem through what's become known as the slaughter of the innocents. So what do we know about Herod the Great, and who is he? We have two pictures here of Herod. The one on the right is a fanciful Renaissance portrait of someone who looks sort of Roman, but also kind of sort of Jewish as well. The bust on the left is actually an ancient bust of Herod the Great himself, who looks just like a Roman emperor. And the best way to think of Herod the Great is not to think of him as Jewish at all, because he was not ethnically Jewish, and he certainly wasn't very religiously Jewish either. But he was thoroughly Romanized from top to bottom, and he ruled Israel in this very ambiguous way by at times playing to the Jewish religious parties in order to curry their favor, but in terms of his values and in terms of his principles and in terms of his worldview, he was thoroughly Romanized. Someone's got their mic on, if you could make sure you mute, please. Thank you very much. All right, so Herod the Great came to power is a brief review of the last 180 years of Jewish history before the time of Jesus. In the beginning of the second century BCE, the Jews were occupied by the Greek Empire. Alexander the Great had conquered Israel, which had been under the control of the Persians, who had taken over from the Babylonians. Alexander the Great conquered Israel in 332 BCE. And then when Alexander died, his empire was split between four of his generals. And the generals in Alexandria, called the Ptolemaic dynasty, had taken control of Israel. So Israel was basically controlled from Alexandria in Egypt by the Greek rulers there. But there was a swap of Israel at the beginning of the second century BCE, when the Seleucid Empire, that's the northeastern quadrant of the Greek Empire, attacked the northwestern quadrant. The Seleucids, based in Syria, attacked the Egyptian part of the Greek Empire, the Ptolemies in Egypt, and were roundly defeated by the Ptolemaic dynasty, but they seized Israel as a consolation prize on their way out. And their monarch was called Antiochus Epiphanes, or Antiochus Epiphanes IV. He attempted to Hellenize Israel, to impose Greek culture and Greek civilization on Israel. He tried to ban synagogue worship. He tried to eliminate the Hebrew language, you know, commit cultural genocide against the Jews, ban circumcision. And of course, most infamously, he tried to put a statue of Zeus, the Greek, great Greek god, in the temple in Jerusalem. And that led to a revolt called the Maccabean Revolt, launched by a clan of priests in Israel. It rumbled on for about 25 years, from 167 to 142 BCE, and it led to the defeat of the Greeks, the victory of the Maccabeans and the Hasmoneans, as they were known, and the Hanukkah miracle of the burning of the menorah for 8 straight days with only 1 day's worth of oil that's celebrated in the recent season of Hanukkah. That dates back to this conflict in the 2nd century BCE. The Hasmonean priestly clan then declared themselves to be the monarchs of Israel, which caused all sorts of upheaval and split Israel into multiple different factions that we're familiar with from the Christian scriptures, like the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Zealots and the Essenes living out in the Dead Sea Scrolls community. And the Hasmonean kingdom lasted for about 80 years, always teetering on the brink of civil war as Israel factionalized. And in fact, civil war did break out in the year 63 BCE, which led to the local Roman general — this was at the end of the Republic — General Pompey, who was based in Alexandria, intervening in that civil war and creating a client kingdom for one of the Hasmonean rulers, Hyrcanus II, and then imposing a Roman military governor to basically be the puppet master of Hyrcanus. And his name was Antipater. He must have had a very awkward relationship with his father, because if you know any Latin, Antipater means against the father. Antipater was an Idumean, which means he was from the land of Edom in the south of Israel. He was half Jewish, but also exceptionally Romanized as well. So Pompey thought he was a good governor who would look after the interests of Israel, but also the interests of Rome. Well, Rome is collapsing into chaos at the end of the Republic. There is civil war between Caesar and Pompey and Mark Antony. Pompey is killed. Antipater helped Caesar escape from Alexandria. And then expresses loyalty instead to the regional power in that area, who was Mark Antony. Caesar is assassinated. Now Antipater is in trouble because he had favored Mark Antony in Caesar's assassination, and Caesar's nephew Octavian is now on the ascendancy. And so Antipater ends up getting poisoned in 43 BCE. And one of his sons, who he had placed in charge of the northern area of Israel as the local governor, a man called Herod, gets in trouble when one of the remaining members of the Hasmonean family encourages the Parthian Empire, who are approximately where Iraq and Iran is today, to attack Israel and to depose the puppet king of Hyrcanus and impose their own king called Aristobulus. And Herod, who would try to fight back on behalf of the Romans, escapes to Rome and begs Octavian to now make him the king of Israel. So in 37 BCE, the Roman Senate declares that Antipater's son, Herod, is now the client king of Israel, and sends him in with an army to defeat the Parthians and to drive out Aristobulus, the pretender. And from that point onwards, Herod becomes the king of Israel, the client king of Israel. I mean, the real ruler of Israel at this time is the late Roman Republic, which will soon, in the next 10 years, become the Roman Empire when Octavian declares himself to be Caesar Augustus. So that's the rather complex and turbulent period of history that leads up to the rise of Herod the Great. So this shows the strategic importance of Israel to the Romans, because look, the Roman Empire surrounds the Mediterranean Ocean Sea. Remember, the Mediterranean literally means in Latin the middle of our land. So the Mediterranean surrounds all of the land controlled by the Romans. And this piece of land here was very important, because the Romans wanted to keep this as a bulwark to the Parthians and the Arabians to make sure that they couldn't interfere with the hegemony of Roman power or the important trade routes that go through Egypt that link the Roman Empire to India and to China and to the East. So this was a very strategically important piece of land, just as it been a very strategically important piece of land for the last 1,000 years between the local superpowers of Egypt to the southwest and the Mesopotamians and Babylonians and Persians and Parthians to the east. So who was Herod the Great? What kind of a person was he? I was just thinking about this last night. Herod's policy basically was make Israel great again, hashtag MEGA. He inherited an Israel, a land that had been under decline for the last half a millennium. They'd been under the control of various foreign powers. Their infrastructure, their land, their morale was all in decline. And Herod the Great, who earned that moniker, was determined through massive building projects to create a prestigious piece of territory that would be the envy of the Eastern Mediterranean. He wanted to make a kind of Greco-Roman masterpiece in that part of the world. And Jerusalem in particular was going to be his Athens of the East. He was a master builder on a massive scale. And he was a tremendously ambiguous figure as well to the Jews. I was just thinking about that other parallel with our current president too. If you search up on Google, Donald Trump and Cyrus the Great, you find many images, many memes, many sermons, many blog posts, because there is some verses in 2 Isaiah in which 2 Isaiah says that Cyrus the Great is being raised up as a Mashiach, a Messiah, basically a king selected by God to fulfill the purposes of God in Israel, because Cyrus the Great, of course, was the Persian ruler who allowed the Jewish exiles to return to Israel and help subsidize the rebuilding of the destroyed temple. In the same way, many evangelical Christians in America see Donald Trump, even though he's not really one of them. Nobody's idea of a devout Christian, but nevertheless, like Cyrus the Great, a foreigner helping Israel in the 6th century BCE, Donald Trump has helped the evangelical Christians in America in the 21st century to achieve their moral, social, cultural, and religious agenda. So there's a tremendous parallel then between Herod the Great, who, as I said, is not really Jewish. He's ethnically Idumean, which is practically Arab. He also married, his father had married a Nabataean princess. Nabataea was the empire based in Petra in modern day Jordan. So he was doubly Arab in terms of his heritage. And he only kind of played a devout Jew on TV. Behind closed doors, his empire and his rule of life, his cultural values were all entirely Romanized and would have seemed very pagan and very obscene and debauched to most of his contemporaries. But he was a builder, and it was through his building projects that he was going to make Israel a great nation again. So one of the first building projects he set about was at Hebron. Hebron is the ancient burial site, very, very holy to the Jews, where the great patriarchs are all buried in a set of caves in Hebron, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and their spouses. If you go to Hebron today, it's about 15 to 20 miles south of Jerusalem. It's in the West Bank, so it's in Palestinian territory, but it has been heavily settled by ultra-Orthodox Jews who have built a whole series of illegal settlements around Hebron. Hebron is a city, it's the second biggest city in the West Bank after Ramallah. It has about 250,000 Palestinian Arabs living there, but there are about 4,000 or 5,000 Jewish settlers there now, and about 30,000 members of the Israeli Defense Force protecting those 4,000 to 5,000 Jewish settlers from the local Palestinian population. So when you go down there today, I mean, it really is like going into a militarized zone. These are the checkpoints you can see. This is the always the Israeli settlerites are on the high ground, much more beautiful modern complexes. And then you get down into the center of Hebron, and of course, the place you're going to visit, there are soldiers everywhere. Is this place here, which is known as the Cave of the Patriarchs. Now, this was just a set of caves at the time of Herod the Great, but then Herod built the first permanent structure over the top of those caves. So he built a synagogue on top of the caves, and then this has been rebuilt a number of times. It was reworked slightly under Constantine. Then the Crusaders built on it as well, and then the Crusader structure was turned into a mosque during the Mamluk and the Ottoman period. When Israel took control of Hebron during the 1967 war, the Israelis carved out a space for them, basically bisected the mosque so that they would have access to the Cave of the Patriarchs as well. So when you go in there, it's a very fortified, segregated area with one separate entrance on one side for the Muslims so they can worship and another entrance on the other side. So these are the steps up to the mosque. Most of the mosque that you can see today is the Crusader structure with the alterations that were made by the Ottomans. It's a beautiful building. This is one of the prayer halls. And then this is the main mosque with all the worship times there. They were doing some restoration work the first time I was there in 2011. And then this well is very, very interesting. So when the Israeli troops entered the mosque in 1967 during the Six-Day War, the head of the Israeli troops, Moshe Dayan, found a little Palestinian girl in Hebron, and they opened up this entrance and they lowered her down with a flashlight. And she was the first person, we think, in hundreds of years to explore the caves that are underneath where the Cave of the Patriarchs is, or where this structure is today. And she was able to verify that there were actual burial sites down there. And then she was brought back up again. Control of the mosque was returned to the Muslims, who looked very unfavorably on what they saw was a desecration of their ancestors, because Abraham and the patriarchs are also the descendants of Ishmael, or the ancestors of Ishmael, from whom all Arabs trace their own descent. And it was sealed up again. But you can see various mausoleums and tombs that are built over the top of the caves, which are supposed to commemorate the patriarchs. And then when you go around the other side, again, through a series of checkpoints, you enter the Israeli entrance to the Cave of the Patriarchs, which has been carved out in the last 50 years. And inside now is a yeshiva, which is basically a school where the ultra-Orthodox go to study Torah. And this is, you know, carved out of one half of what was the former mosque. And then kind of in between, you know, there are some of the graves of the patriarchs. You know, this is the Muslim side on the mosque entrance, and then this is looking from the yeshiva side on the Israeli side. So, I mean, it's a very graphic example of how this land has literally been carved up. But the original structure here was initially put up by Herod the Great 2,000 years ago. Herod the Great also built this port of Caesarea. The Romans needed a deep water port so that they could move supplies and troops in and out. And Herod experimented with hydraulic concrete. He basically built barges that were loaded up with concrete and then sunk. And he kept piling them one on top of another until he created a breakwater that created a port-like structure. There's no real deep water port on the Israeli coast. It's mostly sandy beaches all the way down from Lebanon, all the way down to the Sinai. But in this artificial way, Herod the Great created his own port. And he built up Caesarea Maritima, which he named after Octavian as a way of kissing up. As a Roman city, as you can see. It has a lighthouse there at the entrance. You can see temples and shrines that were built to the Roman gods. I mean, this is amazing. In the land of Israel, there were temples and shrines to the gods of Rome, so that the Romans would feel totally at home in this place where they would bring their troops and their administrators in and out of Israel at the time of Herod the Great. Today, I mean, you can still see the amphitheater that seats about 6,000 people, and there are still performances there at the amphitheater in Caesarea. And Caesarea was cut off from a water source, so Herod built this insane 30-mile aqueduct coming all the way down from Mount Carmel, all the way down the coast. you know, and of course with an aqueduct, you've got to get the height, the engineering height just right, or else water is going to pool or spill over. And it brought water all the way down to Caesarea Maritima. So this is the beach at Caesarea, and you still, and underneath all these arches, you'll find all the people selling ice creams and sunscreen and all the other local supplies. But it's a testimony to the way in which Herod the Great has imprinted his mark on this landscape. Perhaps the most spectacular example of Herod the Great's dramatic building project is Masada, which is a palace that he built down in the Dead Sea. So as you head east of Jerusalem, you go down into the Judean hills on the way to Jericho. This is the road from Jerusalem to Jericho that was made famous in the parable of the Good Samaritan. About halfway down, you reach sea level. You can get out, there's a little lay-by, and you can stand in front of the sea level sign and be a goof like I am here. There's literally sea level at this point. And then you go down another 1,200 feet to reach the Dead Sea, which you can see in the background here. And about three quarters of the way down the Dead Sea, which is drying up, as you can see, because the Israeli government is taking so much water out of the River Jordan, there is this incredible palatial fortress structure built on a mesa called Masada. There's a triple level palace, as you can see, that Herod the Great built, and then a fortress on top. And he built this because he was terrified that his people would rise up against him because of his immorality and his support for the Romans and the fact that he was a puppet king. So there was a series of fortresses that he built throughout Israel where he could basically hide out for years and years with enough supplies, livestock, grain, water, so that he could wait out the Romans to arrive and save his butt. And you can see here these incredible channels that are built all the way around. Can you see them here? So this is so when the rainwaters hit Masada a few times a year, because this is down in the desert, you know, the day I was there, the first time it was 116 degrees. But the few days that it does rain, these channels capture all the water runoff and then direct the water into cisterns, which collect the water, and they can collect vast amounts of water in those few times that it rains. So they'll have a long water supply for all of that time. So look, you can, if you want to, take the snake path, which is the walkway, the only single file walkway up to Masada, which is a rather treacherous path. Or you can do it the easy way and take the Swiss made, oh, I'm blanking on the name of the thing, you know, the gondolier, the gondola that goes all the way up to the top. And when you get up the top, you find the ruins of Herod's fortress and palace. A lot of the walls are still intact. You get these spectacular views of the Dead Sea behind you, looking to the east, and across the Dead Sea, you look over to Jordan and Mount Nebo, of course, where Moses looked from the mountaintop into the Promised Land 1,300 years earlier. To the west, you can look down and see Roman fortifications, because this was the site of the last stand of the Jewish rebels in the Jewish rebellion between the years 66 and 70. The Jewish rebels who tried to overthrow, drive the Romans out and were destroyed by General Titus, who would later become Emperor Titus, and his father, Vespasian, the emperor, the first emperor in the Flavian dynasty. The Jewish rebels who started the revolt in Jerusalem all congregated in Masada in the year 70, and the Romans built a whole series of fortresses around Masada and besieged them for 3 years. They weren't just going to sit there. They built a siege ramp up the side. We'll see in a moment. But here you can see again, Herod had these mikvahs, these ceremonial bathing pits built in all of his palaces. It's thought that this is one of the things that Herod did to try and show that he was a good Jew. He would engage in these ritual purifications that are similar to what the Essenes practiced, and perhaps are similar to the origins of the baptismal ceremony that John practiced down in the Jordan Valley, just to the north of the Dead Sea. But this is one of the typical Roman heating systems in part of Herod's palace, the hypocaust at Masada as well. But look, this is looking at Masada. Here's the three palaces here, but these are some of the Roman fortifications. Basically, the Romans built a series of forts all the way around Masada. You can see another one here and a wall so no one could get in or out. And then they built a siege ramp at the side. Can you see it here? they built a 1,300 feet tall siege ramp at the spur of Masada. This is what it would have probably looked like at the time of Herod. And then they rolled these tall towers that would have gone up 4 or 5 stories all the way up to the top. And of course, Josephus, the Jewish historian, tells us that just the night before the Romans attacked, all the rebels inside decided to commit suicide rather than be taken alive by the Romans. But it's an incredible structure that Herod the Great built down at Masada. These are some of the other views from Masada and the decorations that you can see in Herod's palace. And this is a very sacred site to Israelis today. All officers in the Israeli army swear their final oaths of loyalty up on Masada. And you can see here a rabbi saying a blessing at one of these swearing in ceremonies. And they basically say, you know, never again will I allow Masada to be taken. It's a kind of a watchword. It's like, remember the Alamo if you're Texan. Never again will we in the Israeli Defense Force allow the Masada to be taken again. Herod, like the Egyptians close by, wanted to make sure that he was remembered. So he built this incredible necropolis for himself, this mausoleum structure. It's a conical hill about 12 miles between Jerusalem and Hebron, just north of Hebron. It's about an 800 foot hill that you kind of circumambulate to get up to it. And then at the top, this has all been robbed by grave robbers now, but this would have been enclosed at the top, and there was a kind of Greco-Roman temple structure at the top, and then a whole series of tunnels dug into the hill, and Herod's actual burial site is located about halfway down the hill, although it's been raided multiple times since then. But I mean, he wanted to make sure that people remembered him with this incredibly grand structure. But of course, the thing that Herod is most famous for is all of the additions he made to Jerusalem, which Jesus would have been familiar with during his life, and which were still under construction at the time when Jesus was born, approximately just before Herod the Great died, which is in about 4 BCE. So let's take a little look at Jerusalem at that time. This is looking at Jerusalem from the south. So this is the high point in Jerusalem, Mount Scopus, where Hebrew University is today. Here you can approximately see the outline of the old city. This is looking to the east in the Judean desert. This is the way down to the Dead Sea, about 13 miles away. This is the Mount of Olives that lies to the east of the old city. And Jesus and his disciples stayed here during the last week of Jesus's life and would walk down the side of the Mount of Olives through the Valley of Kidron with the Garden of Gethsemane at the bottom and then up again to where the temple complex is today. You can see it. Now, this is the original part of Jerusalem. This was the Canaanite city that was then developed by King David about 3,000 years ago. And there's a lot of excavations going on in this area, which is known as the City of David today. It's a Palestinian area in East Jerusalem, but is now there have been many compulsory purchases by Israeli settlers and huge amounts of archaeological work going on here. This is what's known as Mount Zion to the south, and then the Hinnom Valley circles around the southern side of the escarpment. And you can see the wall of the old city here that was originally going back to the time of David and Solomon, and then it was extensively rebuilt by Herod the Great, the wall structure, and then the wall structure that we see today was renovations and improvements made by Suleiman the Magnificent during the Ottoman period in the 16th century. So this is a slightly closer view of the old city today. So you can see the edge, the southern edge of the old city, the eastern edge here, the northern edge. Here, of course, it's the temple complex with the Dome of the Rock and the Al-Aqsa Mosque. This is where the Western Wall Plaza is. This is the steps up to the southern side of the temple. And this is the City of David or the old Mount Zion here. And then this is Gethsemane down here with the Church of All Nations. And then this is the Mount of Olives. And then this is the famous Jewish graveyard, the Israeli graveyard that's right opposite the temple complex. This is what the old city would have looked like at the time of Jesus, you know, dominated by the temple complex, which took up almost a quarter of the entire city of Jerusalem. And then the upper city is over here. This is where Herod had built his palace. There's an old palace for the Hasmonean monarchy here, but Herod built himself a new palace. This is now the Citadel, if you've been to Jerusalem today. And then you can see inner and outer walls that Herod built. And then this is the old lower city, which is part of the old Zion settlement that dates back to the time of David. And then the Valley of Kidron here, Mount of Olives, and then the Hinnom Valley to the south. This is what it looks like today. So the old city is smack bang in the dividing line between the West Bank, which is this area here, and the modern state of Israel over here. So there's this massive expansion of Jerusalem in the western districts. These are all the suburbs that have been built by the Israelis since the 1967 war. This is East Jerusalem here, which is still technically under the control of the Palestinian Authority. And this is, and then the old city sits right in the middle of where approximately the dividing line is between East and West Jerusalem. And this is a map of the four quarters that make up the old city today. The largest quarter is the Muslim quarter, which takes up the northeast and pretty much surrounds the Temple Mount. Then the Jewish quarter has been built up since 1967 when the state of Israel took control of Jerusalem from Jordan in the Six-Day War. And many Israelites have taken property and land in this quarter. And they're increasingly buying property that becomes available in the Muslim quarter as well. So it's like a little microcosm of Israel itself. There are little Jewish enclaves all the way through the Muslim quarter in the old city today. This is the Christian quarter in the northwest, which is where the Church of the Holy Sepulchre is. And many churches have their cathedrals here. The Lutherans are here. The Greek Orthodox are here. And the Armenians are down here in the southwest. The actual Episcopal Cathedral, the Anglican Cathedral St. George's is up here, just north of where the Damascus Gate is. So the most famous view we have of Jerusalem is this famous view that you've all seen from the Mount of Olives, looking down, here's the graveyard, looking down to the Kidron Valley, Gethsemane is over here, and then this is that famous view. So here's the Temple Mount here. The Western Wall is complex, is just here behind the Alaska Mosque. And you can just, this is the famous tower of the Lutheran Cathedral there. And you can just about pick out the Church of the Holy Sepulchre behind the Dome of the Rock. And the Damascus Gate is up here. And this is where St. George's Cathedral, the Anglican Cathedral is. It's kind of a little bit of a circus today because so many people come here to take pictures. You can stand on a camel, you can get on a camel for a picture. You can even get like a Palestinian Uber and ride down the Mount of Olives on a donkey, just as Jesus may have done to enter Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. And then this is a slightly closer picture where you can see, of course, this is the Jewish Temple Mount, the most holy site in Israel. This is the Dome of the Rock, one of the most holy sites in Islam. And then of course, here are the two domes of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre behind it, probably the most holy site in all of Christendom as well. So all three great Abrahamic monotheistic religions there crammed into one camera shot. So let me just take you for a little walk through the old city. So when I've been in Jerusalem, I've always stayed in Eastern Jerusalem in the Palestinian area, very near to where St. George's Cathedral is. And you come in through the Damascus Gate in the north. It's always kind of a packed marketplace in this area. It's a great place to people watch, a great place to hang out in the evening. And the last two times I've been in Israel in 2015 and 2011, it's been Ramadan during the time I've been there. So this is always a very, very busy place after the sun goes down and all the Palestinians, Arabs who have been down to pray at the Temple Mount are coming up out of the Damascus Gate. Remember, Jerusalem's name is from the verb, from the word salam or shalom, in both Arabic and Hebrew, which supposedly indicates peace, one of the ironies. There are, of course, Romans to welcome you to. This shows some of the decorations on the other side. This is the inside of the Damascus Gate, all decked out for Ramadan. You can see the lights that are up everywhere. It's like a typical Arab souk that you can find anywhere over the across the Middle East, across North Africa. You could be in Morocco, you could be in Istanbul. You could be in Damascus. This is the Muslim quarter. You can even get a tattoo. even though that's against Islamic teaching. You know, there's the crescent moon and the stars available for your Ramadan decorations. Essential SpongeBob and Barbie and Shaun of the Sheep, mementos from your time in Jerusalem. Lots of fantastic cafes, spice markets. I love this one with the dome on the rock on this mountain of spice with pomegranate juice here. And then this is in the Christian quarter, very near to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And of course, the sorts of knickknacks that they're selling are much more now Christian orientated. Just a typical scene in the Muslim quarter. It's a beautiful place to wander through. Lots of ancient architecture and arches and one period built on top of another period. And a nice framing shot of the Dome of the Rock coming down from the north. And of course, you know, there are all sorts of different ethnicities and cultures, all the different ultra-Orthodox groups who live in Jerusalem, wandering through the old city. You can always recognize the different sects, usually by the different clothes and the different hats that they wear. This is Starbucks, a Palestinian side. This is a guy with a massive samovar of tea, and he'll kind of lean over in order to pour you a little cup of tea. And there's some great mementos from your trip to Israel. America, don't worry, Israel is behind you. And there's even special gift shops named after different stations of the cross. And this is in the Christian quarter where you can get all your Christian knickknacks. More depictions of the Last Supper than you can shake a stick at. But everywhere you look, you know, there's a very heavy Israeli Defense Force and police presence. This is all in the Muslim quarter, and this can always be a source of tension. At times they'll just, if they perceive a security threat, they'll close off the streets, they'll block access to the Temple Mount. And if it's prayer time, that's a source of tremendous conflict. So the Via Dolorosa runs through most of the old city. You can see it here. It starts at the Church of St. Anne near the eastern edge of the old city and runs approximately along the northern edge of the temple complex, and then kind of doglegs here, and then enters into the Church of the Holy Sepulchre complex in the Christian quarter over here. This is approximately what it looks like on a satellite image, and you can see all the different stations of the cross marked out here, the last five stations being inside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre itself. So there you go. It's thought that it starts in the Antonia Fortress, which is a Roman fort that was built on the northern side of the temple where Jesus was being held by Pilate. And then this is where Jesus is scourged and condemned, supposedly. This is where, according to John's gospel, Jesus is brought out before the crowd, and Pilate says, "Behold the man, ecce homo," and then Jesus is led outside of the city at that time to a place called Golgotha, which is near a quarry. We'll look at that a little bit more in a moment, and then is crucified out by the quarry in Golgotha outside the city gates, which would run approximately here, and then would have been buried in a tomb hewn out of a rock very, very close by. And both those locations, the Golgotha Hill and the cave tomb, are supposedly contained within the structure of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. So these are just some views. Every time you get to one of the stations of the cross, there's usually a little chapel built into the wall somewhere. This is supposedly a place where Jesus leaned on the rock to steady himself. And it's, you know, obviously Jesus exerted a tremendous amount of pressure because his hand made a print in the wall. And you can now put your hand, like I did there, into the handprint of Jesus. This is, you know, typical of the stuff you find all the way through the Holy Land. Things that are just completely made up and claim to be authentic and religious, but were probably just created for the sake of tourists. And then as you get closer and closer, you get to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, and it opens out into a courtyard, and it's a pretty modest entrance to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre down here. Famously, there are five different religious groups that have access and some dominion over the Church of the Holy Sepulchre: the Roman Catholics, the Greek Orthodox, the Armenians, the Syrian Orthodox, and the Ethiopian Orthodox as well. They don't get on well together. They constantly bicker over their jurisdiction and the times when they have worship. And one of the great signs of this that is very famous is this ladder that apparently was left up here by one of the windows. This is one of the windows next to the Golgotha Chapel. It was left there, it was thought sometime in the 1950s, but the five groups can't decide amongst them who was responsible for leaving it there, and therefore none of them will lose face by taking it down. So it's that ladder has been there for 70 years now as a kind of infamous reminder of the inability of these so-called Christian religious groups to get along and accept responsibility for their actions. So moving down to the Temple Mount, which is mentioned specifically in the gospel story of Jesus's birth in Luke, where Mary and Joseph come up from Bethlehem about 4 miles to the south perform a series of rituals to thank God for the safe delivery of a child, the fact that Mary, his mother, is healthy, the fact that the child is healthy, and the fact that the child is a boy, and the fact that the child, of course, is destined to be the Messiah and is the Son of God. So this is Mount Moriah. According to tradition, the mountain supposedly where Abraham almost sacrificed Isaac, which is a story that's important both to Jews and to Muslims, although, and of course, in the Muslim version in the Quran, Abraham almost sacrifices Ishmael, not Isaac. The square here shows the original platform that Solomon built over what was a threshing floor that David had purchased. David's city is down here on Zion, but David had purchased this threshing floor on the side of Mount Moriah, but was not allowed himself to build the temple because of all the blood on his hands as a warrior. It was his son, Solomon, who inherited the peace dividend, who was allowed to build the temple. So Solomon built this platform here and then constructed his temple. Now the Hasmoneans extended the platform during their reign, and then Herod the Great extended it even further, both to the west and to the south. So look, you can see all these kind of vaults underneath the hill. I mean, Herod basically adds to the hill here. You can see how sharp the escarpment is, but there are all these kind of subterranean vaults that were built up by Herod so that then he could construct his massive platform, which you can see here, which, you know, is almost double the size of Solomon's platform by reclaiming additional hillside and is about the size of 12 football fields. It's absolutely massive. So this is what it looks like from above today, and you can see approximately this is where Solomon's temple would have been originally, and then this is all the extra reclaimed land that Herod built on his temple. Here's the Western Wall Plaza, the Wailing Wall Plaza. This is the Al-Aqsa Mosque, which is the third most important mosque in Islam, dating back to the early 8th century of the Common Era, after the mosque in Mecca, where the Kaaba is, and the mosque in Medina, where Muhammad is buried. This is the third most important mosque in Islam. And then this is not a mosque, it's the Shrine of the Rock, or the Dome of the Rock, which is built supposedly over the site where Abraham almost sacrificed Ishmael / Isaac, depending on which religion you belong to. And some think this is perhaps where the Holy of Holies was in Solomon's temple, or in the Herodian version of the temple. Other people think the Holy of Holies may have been a little bit further west, where you can see there's two little domes here in the Muslim complex. It's thought that one of these may mark where the Holy of Holies was in Herod and Solomon's temple. So if you want to see what Jerusalem looked like at the time of Jesus, you can go to the National Museum of Israel in Western Jerusalem. It's just opposite where the Knesset is. This is the Israeli parliament. And there is this incredible scale model that was originally in the grounds of a hotel in Jerusalem. And when that hotel closed, it was moved to the grounds of the National Museum of Israel. But it's this incredible model that was being built to show approximately what Israel was like during the time of Herod. And you can see all the massive building work and all of the modernization and the Greco-Roman style that Herod the Great had added to this place, including outside of the city walls here, you can see Golgotha. This was the quarry that's just outside of the walls. This is supposedly where Jesus was crucified. And here are a series of the cave tombs, or the tombs hewn out of rock, supposedly where Jesus was buried. So I've got a little video to show you of what Israel, what Jerusalem was like at the time. What Jerusalem was like at the time of Jesus. So this is actually a model that's in Egypt, of all places. There's a kind of Bible Holy Land experience in Egypt, and there's a scale model there of Jerusalem, and this is someone who filmed that scale model. So of course, here you can see Herod's temple. This is where the Al-Aqsa Mosque today is. This is where the Wailing Wall is today. This is the Valley of Kidron and Gethsemane down here. So this is the Eastern Entry, the Golden Gate Entry, as it's called. And then you can see here, Herod built this massive fortress in the corner for the Romans. It's known as the Antonia Fortress, or named after Mark Antony, who was at that time Herod's patron before he switched his loyalty to Octavian. But imagine what it was like for the Jews at the time of Jesus. They're there in the temple, worshiping their God, and looking down on them as if they're from prison watchtowers are Roman soldiers in the Antonia Fortress who were there to keep law and order. So this is Upper Jerusalem over here, behind the temple. This is the actual temple shrine, and the Holy of Holies is inside this building here. So that's the actual sacred space of the temple itself. All the rest is the temple platform. This is Lower Jerusalem. This is the city of David. This is Mount Zion. And then here's Upper Jerusalem. You can see Herod's palace just in the west over there. Now this is looking from the south. So these are the steps up to the temple, and then you'd enter those hallways. There's also, this is Robinson's Arch. This is another way up into the temple. This is where the Wailing Wall Plaza is today. This is Barclays Gate, another way into the temple as well. You can see how big the platform is that Herod the Great built. That's the sacrificial temple again. And this is looking from up to Jerusalem in the west. There's a city wall, and this is where Golgotha would have been, just outside the city walls. But yes, there's a little cross mark inside there. That's the other place. Okay, so let me take you now inside Herod's temple. This is a 3D model, computer model of what Herod the Great's temple would have looked like at the time of Jesus. So again, this is looking to the south here. This is where the Wailing Wall Plaza is today, and the Al-Aqsa Mosque is here. There are these porticos that go all the way around the temple. And then this huge open area here is the courtyard of Gentiles. So this is Herod the Great wanted this to be a place that tourists could come and visit and gawp at. And then there are these inner sanctums where the actual temple complex is itself. This is the courtyard of Israel in here where only Jews could go. There's a courtyard of women here where only women could go. And then another series of gateways that take you into the courtyard of Israel where only Jewish males could go. And then the priest courtyard, and then the sanctuary of the temple itself, which had the Holy of Holies, the most holy site of the temple inside that. And then there's some dispute about where the pinnacle of the temple is. Some people think the pinnacle of the temple is on top of the sanctuary here. This is famously mentioned, of course, in the temptation story in Luke, where Jesus is encouraged by the devil to throw himself off the pinnacle of the temple so angels can rescue him as a proof of faith. Other people think the pinnacle of the temple is on top of the southern portico here, because the way in which Herod had built up the platform, there would have been a massive drop here of about 14 stories.
Okay. Hey, YouTube, if you want.
So there was a chance for you to see a little bit of what the temple looked like at the time of Jesus. So let's go back now then to, this is the structure. So you can see, look, this is the, this is from the northeast corner. The southwest corner over here is where the Wailing Wall is today. But look, you can see these massive blocks that Herod built up his platform. What survives today at the Wailing Wall Plaza is not the temple itself, which was on top. It's basically the wall of the platform. But these stones that were quarried just north of Jerusalem up near Mount Scopus, some of these blocks were up to 40 feet long and 13 feet high and wide, weighing up to 70 tons. Herod brought in engineers from Egypt and from Rome and from Greece to engage in this massive construction project. He had over 1,000 priests involved in the building itself, and of course, tens of thousands of slave laborers who helped do the heavy lifting. And massive amounts of vicious taxation on the local population to pay for this. So look, the Jews got this massive, incredible, brand new temple that was one of the wonders of the world, but at the same time, they really paid for it in terms of enslavement and vicious taxation. This is another view then from the northeastern corner, the Antonia Fortress you can see here, and then the temple complex itself. And then this is within the sanctuary itself, the main hall of the sanctuary, and then the veil of the temple that hangs here, this massive veil that supposedly rips in two from top to bottom when Jesus dies, according to Mark's gospel, indicating the presence of God inside the Holy of Holies, escaping from the temple, or of course, these veils being ripped as a symbol of unveiling or revelation of what Jesus's death signifies, according to Mark. Now, looking from the southwest corner then, this is the Wailing Wall or the Western Wall Plaza today, and you get up to the top of the Temple Mount by going up this kind of wooden trestle bridge that takes you up to the level of the platform itself. This is an artist's impression, so you see the Al-Aqsa Mosque down here in the south, and then the Dome of the Rock in the middle. And this is the Al-Aqsa Mosque. Unfortunately, since September 11th, it's been closed to non-Muslims because of threats made by Christian fundamentalists, terrorist threats made against the mosque. So now nobody is allowed in unless you're a Muslim. This is what it looks like inside. It's built over the top of those vaults that Herod built. And so it's structurally unstable. It's fallen down a couple of times because of earthquakes and been rebuilt many times. So there's not much inside that's authentic going back 1300 years ago to when it was constructed. But this is built on the rock itself and is this incredible structure that was built at the end of the 7th century of the Common Era by the Muslim Caliphate, and then restored in the 1960s with funding from King Hussein of Jordan, King Abdullah's father, including $13 million of gold on top of the dome itself and all that beautiful tile work. It really is an incredible structure. And again, since September 11th, no one is allowed inside except Muslims, so Christians can't get in anymore. But this is what on a cross section of the building. And then this is the dome from the inside, just beautiful Islamic architecture, with that beautiful figurative style. And then this is supposedly the rock where Abraham almost sacrificed Ishmael / Isaac. And then these are the porticos and the wide open spaces that surround the Dome of the Rock. I'm going a little bit quickly now because I'm mindful of time, but during Ramadan or during Friday prayers, you know, hundreds of thousands of people pour into this complex. You can get up to about 500,000 people in the temple complex during Ramadan for noonday prayers on Friday. which is must be an incredible gathering of people. But there are members of the Israeli security services all over here as well, because they're terrified of riots or problems breaking out. They're also worried about Orthodox Jews trying to get up here. If you can remember, Ariel Sharon, the former prime minister of Israel, started the Second Intifada in the year 2000 when he and a group of supporters breached the Temple Mount in violation of agreements with the local Palestinian and Muslim authorities. When I was there in 2011, there was a group of Palestinian school children who had come there for a visit, and there's members of the Israeli security forces there, and the teachers of the Palestinian school children arranged for them to march past all the Israeli security guards shouting death to Israel, which is, you know, a good lesson for the children. And the Israelis just got out their cameras and filmed everyone, so presumably they could go and visit those teachers in the West Bank later that week, or mark them as a security threat. So the Wailing Wall Plaza is entered either from the south in the Israeli quarter or from the north in the Muslim quarter. You have to go through a checkpoint, of course, because they don't want Palestinian Arabs going into this complex. They just want Western tourists and Israelis in there. So you go through a series of checkpoints and tunnels, and then you exit into the plaza itself. This is the closest that most Jews can get to where they believe the Holy of Holies was on Solomon and Herod's temple. So it's the most sacred site in Judaism. This is what it looks like. So remember, this is not the temple itself. This is just simply the wall of the platform, but you can see the size of these incredible stones. These are additions that were put up by Solomon the Magnificent here on the top. But these stones here are the original platform stones from the time of Herod the Great. There are lots of Orthodox there, worshiping, reading Torah, praying. And then, of course, anyone can get up close and pray and write a prayer and insert it in between the stones. To the north, there is a tunnel that goes all the way alongside the platform now, so Jewish men can worship in an air-conditioned, cool, sheltered environment. Of course, Jewish women are not so lucky. They're stuck outside in the plaza in the ferocious heat of the summer with no shade at all. But for the Jewish men, of course, Orthodox Judaism is quite a misogynistic culture, have all their needs taken care of. These are the kind of giant cabinets in which Torah scrolls are kept. So this is the Jewish female area. I mean, they do have a couple of sun umbrellas out here. And there's that wooden bridge structure that leads tourists onto the Temple Mount. And these are all the lecterns that are here, so people can grab them and just start reading Torah. Or you'll also see lots of bar mitzvahs taking place here as well. And then this is the subdivision between where the women are and where the men are. See, the women have a teeny little section here, no shade at all this day, but much, much bigger section for the men. This is a prayer that I wrote in 2011. It's a prayer that my son used to have at his preschool. We wish for peace, love, happiness, and health and food for all the people of the world. That's what my son used to say at his little non-denominational Montessori preschool. And so I wrote that prayer and added that in and put that in the wall. Perhaps you can remember infamously when President Obama was here about 10 years ago, someone took out his prayer and then published it, which was a huge violation of rabbinical rules. That person got into a lot of trouble. I was rather amused one day I was there to see this huge bag. Presumably someone had taken all the prayers out of the wall so that new prayers could be added in. I have no idea how they disposed of these prayers. What did they do with them? Is there an archive? Do they store them? Did they burn them? What happens to them? Inquiring minds want to know. So finally, just to prove to you that this really is the unholy land, as I call it, these are pictures of scuffles that takes place inside some of the holy sites. This is in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. So I want to leave you today in our journey through the unholy land with some wonderful footage of how the religious leaders behave in the holy sites. So this is in this is in the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. So there was an incident a few years ago where the Greek Orthodox were cleaning with brooms, and then the Syriac Orthodox began cleaning with brooms, and they ended up having a broom fight.
Unholy conduct at the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem, as Greek Orthodox and Armenian clergy attacked each other with brooms in a dispute over sections of the building. Police separated the rival groups and no arrests were made because they're all men of God, according to a lieutenant colonel in the city's force. The scuffles often happen as each faction cleans a different part of the church in preparation for Orthodox Christmas celebrations in January.
All right, so that's in the Church of the Nativity, and this is in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, where similar scuffles break out because there are five different religious groups who have worship rights and jurisdiction over the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And if their service goes like 30 seconds too long, the next group will wait to have their service get very quiet. So that structure behind them, you can see just to the right, is supposedly the tomb of Jesus. This is right happening right in Jesus's tomb under the big dome in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. So I kind of feel like we need that Benny Hill music playing behind it here, but it does remind me of one of my favorite Monty Python sketches of all time.
A local civic group reenacts a famous scene from history. This week, the Townsmen Guild of Sheffield in Yorkshire.
Miss Rita Fairbanks, you organized this representation of the Battle of Pearl Harbor. Why?
Well, we've always been extremely interested in modern works. We were the first Townswomen's Guild to perform Camp on Blood Island. And of course, last year we did our extremely popular reenactment of Nazi war atrocities. So this year we thought we'd do something in a much lighter vein.
Well, I can see that you're all ready to go, so I'll just wish you good luck in your latest venture, the Battle of Pearl Harbor.
Thank you very much indeed, young man.
So there we go. For the 75th anniversary of the Battle of Pearl Harbor, the Tapsley Women's Guild reenacting that great battle from American history. So I'm sorry to end on a bit of a ridiculous note, but that is my rather ambiguous experience of what the Holy Land is like at times. These sites which Christians and Muslims and Jews all regard as very holy, nevertheless, there are these very fallen and fallible human beings who worship there, who take jurisdiction and control there, and frequently misbehave in possessive and ungracious and impious ways. So I hope that's familiarized you a little bit with some of the lands, some of the places that Jesus was familiar with. We've spent some time in Nazareth, we spent some time in Bethlehem, and we spent a little bit of time in Jerusalem as well, seeing the incredible imprint that Herod the Great made on Israel at that time. I know you have service starting soon, so I want to wrap up things here. I'm not sure if I can answer any questions. It gets very, very complicated when there's like 50 people on a Zoom together, but you know, you guys, you have my email at Bishops. If you ever want to email me a question, I'd be happy to reply. But again, I want to thank Jeff and Dean Penny for having me, and I hope you've enjoyed this journey through the not so holy land. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, David. There was a question in the chat. Is the Muslim Quarter controlled by a particular branch of Islam?
No, not. I mean, most of the Muslims that are in Palestine are Sunni Muslims. But I mean, the Islam is very decentralized, as you know. I mean, there is a Grand Mufti of Jerusalem who is the putative head of the Islamic community in that part of the world. But the land, the political jurisdiction, of course, is now disputed between the Palestinian Authority, who still claims authority over East Jerusalem and want to preserve East Jerusalem as a capital for a Palestinian state, and the State of Israel, who claims that this is part of Greater Israel now, and there is this rather nefarious process now. If you see these Israeli flags popping up all over the Muslim Quarter in East Jerusalem as Israeli realtors, real estate investors buy different properties, and the fear amongst the Palestinian community is that they will just eventually be bought out of their own culture itself, which is the fear that Palestinians have in the occupied territories as well.
Thank you again. Fantastic series. Really, really interesting, enlightening. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Have a wonderful, safe, healthy holiday season, everybody. Take care.
Thank you, David. And remember that we have no forum next week. We'll return to the forum in 2 weeks with David Chow and Art and Christianity. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Merry Christmas.
Fantastic, David. Thank you again.
Thank you, David.